Yo, Snapchat, so I was reading this awesome article this morning talking about all these companies that are building tiny rockets. So most rockets range from like 40 to 100 meters tall. These rockets are like less than 10 meters tall, and that's awesome. So SpaceX has been able to undercut all their competitors by building their rockets basically from scratch, from raw materials. But a Falcon 9 launch still costs $60 million, and it's a 70-meter tall rocket. Meaning it currently costs about $8,000 per kilogram to get to geostationary orbit. But obviously with the reusable rockets, they're trying to get that down to $100 per kilogram. The thing is, with the miniaturization of electronics, most satellites are actually getting smaller and smaller. You can pack all of the sensors onto something that's less than 10 kilograms, sometimes even less than 10 grams. They're going to get down to like the micro. I think companies like SpaceX, they're not really interested in creating, getting little tiny things to orbit. They're more interested in making the biggest, baddest rockets with the most efficiency to get the most payload to space to create a Mars colony. So I think it'd be really interesting if you looked at really tiny rockets and really small payloads, like less than 10 kilograms, in the same way that Elon Musk went about looking at big rockets and how you can make them really cheap. Because I definitely think there'll be a SpaceX equivalent worth billions of dollars, but they'll focus only on payload launches less than 10 kilograms, and they'll do multiple launches per day and launch thousands of satellites per day. You kind of end up with like an API for space because you'd have these, you know, basically instant access to anything in space. You could have millions of constellations of satellites and just on demand, and you can reprogram them or you can send your... Like imagine if you could basically design all the specifications and do all the programming stuff for a satellite today. You send it off to a company, they basically 3D print it tonight, and tomorrow they launch it into space. Wow. What they could also do is almost create like a sharing economy for satellites. So once they have all these satellites up there, any that are being sitting there idle, you could actually rent time on them, on these massive constellations of billions of satellites. I kind of wonder why no one's done that with big satellites now. It seems like every company is launching their own communications satellite. You'd think it would make more sense to just network them all together and kind of share them as one resource. Okay, this leads into another story kind of. Remember the stuff from a few months ago where they thought maybe it was an alien megastructure because the luminosity dipped? Well, it was found over the last 4 years that its luminosity decreased by 3%. So it's likely there's some natural phenomena we just don't know about in the universe yet. Or it could be a Dyson sphere, which is this idea of like wrapping a star to kind of extract all its energy source, which is so cool. And so when you start talking about alien megastructures, you tend to find a lot of the comments will be like, oh, maybe they're building a ship to come here. Like, people have this notion of big, giant spaceships, like what they see in sci-fi, and that's not going to happen. I don't think aliens will be biological because it doesn't make any sense. I mean, we're on a trajectory now where we're going to be non-biological within probably our lifetimes, based on the rate of technology. Like, big spaceships like the Mars Colonial Transporter that Musk is going to be announcing in September this year, that makes sense for colonizing our solar system and, you know, transporting humans, but not interstellar. I mean, right now, humans in biological form, our lifespan is like 80 years. Like, maybe if we maintain biological and add some more enhancements, we can maybe get to 200-year lifespan. But that means even to get to the nearest star system, Alpha Centauri, you're looking at, you would require a multi-generational starship so that people would be born and die on that ship before they even get there. And even if you could develop spaceships that could travel near the speed of light, you're still looking at hundreds of thousands of years to get most places. I mean, the diameter of the Milky Way alone is 100,000 years across. So this common sci-fi notion of like big starships going through space with humans on them makes absolutely no sense because we have short lifespans, we need lots of food and water, we shit everywhere, it just doesn't make any sense. So this sounds bizarre now, but I think the most likely way we'll ever do interstellar travel and actually spread our intelligence throughout the universe is by creating digital representations of humanity on nanosatellites. With the current pace of technology, we're expected to merge with the machines and kind of like upload our minds sometime in around like 30 years, like very early, conservatively 50 years and like 100 years definitely. And when you go from biological form to digital form, when humanity is all digital, then you can create replications, you can simulate, you can create all sorts of copies, like billions of copies, and the only thing you need is energy. So basically when we want to go to Alpha Centauri, or when we want to like impregnate the universe with intelligence, all we do is literally take a copy of all of humanity and put it onto a nano speck that you can't even see with a visible. So then all you need to do is create quadrillions of these little nano satellites that have all the humanity on there, a little copy of us, and send them off at the speed of light using lasers to every known star system. Which is already fairly similar to the project, I think it's called Breakthrough Starshot, which is backed by Yuri Milner, Mark Zuckerberg, and Stephen Hawking, where they plan to use a solar sail and lasers to fire microsatellites at Alpha Centauri. So you have quadrillions of these little advanced nanosatellites with copies of all humanity on them, all still processing slowly inside, but once they get to their destination, their star system, they start replicating. So the nanobots inside those little nanosatellites basically start replicating, finding all the elements in those star systems, in the planets nearby, to replicate, to create more nanobots, to basically spread throughout that whole solar system. Then perhaps if we find existing computational structures, computational processes in those star systems, things like, you know, life and evolution, then we can kind of just like embed ourselves into it and start directing. Or if there is no computational systems on that planet, then we just basically start creating replicators. Things like DNA, RNA, those are basically nanomachines that are computational processes. There's a really interesting thought experiment there that if your civilization is operating at the nanoscale or the femtoscale, how can you actually distinguish that computation from everything else that's already happening in nature? So if humans were to impregnate the universe with intelligence, that's what we do. We spread our intelligence through multiple copies of humanity as little nano-replicators, turn every star system into a Dyson sphere, and then run simulations. And what would you do? You'd simulate basically universes to basically find knowledge, because I feel like knowledge is the unlimited resource. You can never have 100% absolute knowledge. Everything else is fine. Okay, so my whole point of that ramble was that space and technology miniaturizes. This whole sci-fi notion of big alien spaceships and big human spaceships is unlikely. They'll be invisible to human eye.